Ellis, let's talk about summer blockbuster movies. Give us an idea of the box office forecast. We've seen some of these blockbusters come out, and it's been a rather mixed bag. The Flash is less than expected at the box office. Spider-Man has done, I guess, better than expected. What does that forecast look like for the balance of the summer?
The forecast looks very strong, and we are quite excited about a number of movies that are on their way to the theaters. You've got Indiana Jones, you've got Barbie, you've got Mission Impossible, you've got Oppenheimer. So there's a ton of movies still on the way to our cinemas. And don't forget, Super Mario started things off in a big way. For us, which did extremely well, and Spider-Man continues to do well. You are correct, the Flash and Elemental were a little bit less than what we had anticipated, but that's what it is in the movie business. I've been in the business for a considerable time, and you get some that do way more than you expect, and you get others that don't do as well as you expect.
What do you attribute that to? What do you think that's because of?
It's about what the audiences want to see and what the focus of the movie is and how it's marketed and what the impact is. And I remember back in the early days, there was a movie called Home Alone, and we saw the movie and we said, oh, this thing's not going to do much business. And it turned out to be a record movie for our business.
And I've seen it about 585 times now.
Good. Thank you. The movie theater.
Are you seeing, I guess, film studios and distributors release the same number of movies as they did, I guess, prior to the pandemic? Or are they still releasing them to theaters, or are they bypassing that and going straight to streaming? What are you seeing?
No, I just was at CinemaCon, which is the big industry convention in Las Vegas, a short while ago. And one good thing from that convention was all of the major studios are committed to a theatrical window, and they are looking at around the minimum of 45 days. And what's also good news is both Apple and Amazon are now quite interested in getting into the theatrical side of the business. And I keep saying, Larissa, we are the engine that drives the train. And that has proved more and more often through COVID than we were worried about streaming. But after we've come back, the studios are all focused on the theatrical release.
What do you think? We've talked a little bit about this at the start of the conversation. Is it the franchises that do the best that are kind of tried, tested, and true when you take a look at Mission Impossible or Fast and the Furious? What are you seeing happening now? What does that appetite look like?
The franchises, basically, you know what you're going to be getting, and the studios know where they are focusing their dollars. But you look at a movie like, Top Gun or Super Mario's, and those movies did extremely well, and they were not, specifically franchise movies. So you're going to have a mix of both. The area where I think we're going to see much more uptick is in the middle range movies, which we didn't get many releases through the pandemic, but I think they will come back as certain of the studios like Universal with Focus Features will release those movies that appeal to a different demographic as we move forward.
Ellis, we're in this high inflationary environment, high interest rate environment. How do you attract theater goers?
When you look back in all of the recessions that we've had in the past, I think three out of the last four, the movie theaters actually perform better during recessionary periods. And part of that is driven by the fact that guests want a social experience, but traveling and other, going to sporting events and concerts are quite a lot more expensive. So we do provide that experience, and that will continue as we move forward because it still is a great experience that one can have outside the home. And today it's actually cheaper to see a movie inflation adjusted than it was back in the 70s.
And how do you, I guess, get and keep that consumer trust?
We have one of the best loyalty programs in Scene Plus. We know when our guests come, what they see, what they do, and we communicate with them and try to maximize our interactivity with our guests and have personalization and bringing them back into the cinemas.
Later this summer, in August specifically, you report on Q2 of this year, taking a look at that path that Cineplex has been on. Do you expect that upward trend to continue?
Yes, we are going to, and we've disclosed some of our box office and concession numbers, and we expect Q2 to be, a strong quarter for us, and it's one of the better quarters post-pandemic that Cineplex will have.
Lastly, Ellis, when you take a look at that theater model, you've mentioned just the other components, the VIP theaters, the experiences that are attached to going to the theater. Who is doing it right? Do you look at other theaters around the world? Do you try to model yourself after another theater experience?
Great question. And it's interesting because whenever I travel and my wife would say, we're not stopping at the theater. I said, yes, of course we are. So in every country we go to, including places like Thailand and Vietnam, I go and visit with her the theaters. And you pick up some great ideas and basically use some of those ideas where it's appropriate. So, I look at our VIPs. The VIP I looked at was in Australia and decided what we would do in Canada. And if you ask anybody in North America, our Canadian experience is significantly better than a lot of the other VIPs. And today you can see a movie 9 different ways at Cineplex, which wasn't available when I first started in the business.